My name is Irene Claire Stevens Griffin. Here is what I would like you to remember about me. It started when I was born on December 30, 1941, in Oswald Twistle, Lancashire, England. All things considered, being born in 1941, during World War II, and requiring major surgery to save my life, I was fortunate to have survived. My mother had 3 children in 3 years. I was born in King Oswald's Twistle. A twistle is a neck of land between 2 rivers, and that's how Oswald Twistle got its name. Cobbled streets, no electricity, coal fireplace, galvanized bathtub, outdoor toilet and coconut matting for carpeting. Aside from skinned knees and in spite of it all, I was a happy child. The moors of Oswald Twistle were not far from where we lived, and we would spend lots of time exploring them. The barrage balloons set up to snag the German V-1 flying bombs were nothing more than big toys for us to play around. My father, Norman Ambrose Stevens, was born in 1915 in England. His occupation was toolmaker with the Royal Air Force. My mother, Mae McLaughlin, was born in 1916, also in England. When they married in 1937, my mother was 1 year younger than my father. My eldest sister, Patricia, was born in 1938. Pat emigrated to Australia in 1972, where she married and had a daughter, Rebecca. My brother Trevor was born in 1939. Trevor never traveled from our hometown of Oswald Twistle, where he married and had 3 children, a daughter and twin boys. My interest in singing started when, as a child, I would listen to my sister singing scales. I thought to myself, well, I can do that. There was no stopping me. I began working in the cotton mills of Oswald Twistle. I was 14, and I could sing to my heart's content, because nobody could hear me over the cacophony of the weaving machines. I began singing professionally in the clubs on weekends. My true love at the time was Gilbert and Sullivan, and I had many opportunities to perform my favorite roles. The most exciting happening in my life was winning the weekly national TV show on Thames Television, called Opportunity Knocks, and I continued to win for several weeks thereafter. I was seen on one of the shows by an American entrepreneur named Fred Waring, and he invited me to join his touring group, the Pennsylvanians. In September of 1969, I boarded an international flight, bound for Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. There I was met by a private aircraft, and was flown through the Delaware Water Gap, and finally landing at a local airport in Stroudsburg, Pennsylvania. Once there, I was introduced to the Pennsylvanians as they were in the middle of a rehearsal. I was simply overwhelmed and even somewhat intimidated by the amazingly beautiful sounds that were emanating from this talented assembly of people. There followed an 8-month tour of America, where I met Paul Griffin, who was the first trumpet player and musical orchestrator. We traveled the length and breadth of the North American continent and performed in most of the major cities. We spent several weeks in certain locations, including Las Vegas and Reno, Nevada, where I would greet Bertha the Elephant every night before our show at Johnny Asquaga's Golden Nugget. In April 1970, when the tour ended and my visa expired, I returned to the UK, and on May 29, 1970, Paul joined me. And so it was that we began our lives together. We worked many wonderful venues around the British Isles, including Scotland, Wales and Ireland, along with our talented dog, Spotty, who travelled with us everywhere. Paul was born in 1944, in New York, and he was 26 years old when we married, 3 years younger than me. His occupations were musician, trumpet player, orchestrator, and audio-video producer. We met with the magistrate 1 week earlier, so that he could take down our details. Parents' names and occupations. When he came to Paul, he asked his father's name, and Paul replied Gordon Chris Griffin. He then asked father's occupation, to which Paul answered, musician, trumpet player. The magistrate asked, not the Chris Griffin with Benny Goodman. When Paul replied yes, well, as it turned out, the magistrate was a big band enthusiast. We enjoyed extra special treatment for our wedding day. I married my wonderful husband, Paul Leslie Griffin, on July 10, 1971, at age 29 in England. I still remember it as if it were yesterday. We were married in Blackburn, Lancashire. We held our reception at our home, where we had prepared refreshments and beverages for an afternoon of entertainment for family and a few of our closest friends. Unfortunately, Paul's family was unable to be with us due to visa and passport issues. We finally met with the Griffin family as Mr. and Mrs. in 1972. 12 years later, we returned to America and another adventure began. We first settled in Long Beach, Long Island, where we put our many talents into property development. Paul was confident about his ability to turn his hand to electrical, plumbing and cabinet making, along with carpentry and sheetrock. I was there as his apprentice while anticipating his every need. The results were always satisfying. At the same time, Paul was breaking back into the music business, and he worked his way in as a substitute trumpet player on several Broadway shows. We would work on the property as much as we could before we would walk the 2 blocks to the beach and get refreshed before Paul would have to change into his tuxedo and drive into New York City. We began doing what was known at the time as industrial shows, such as IBM Computers, or General Electric, and other such large corporations. I was able to fulfill the dream of my life by singing my favorite roles with the Delaware Valley Opera Company. The icing on the cake was performing Mimi in La Boheme. In 1987, Paul and I were privileged to have been invited to take part in a splendid occasion, a special performance for none other than the future President of the United States, Donald Trump, and his esteemed assembly of 200 guests, hosted at the illustrious Trump Plaza in the heart of New York City. During the midst of my performance, I graciously extended the microphone to the Donald, affording him the opportunity to address his esteemed company. It was with great delight that I found myself humbled by his discreet embrace, and he, in his charming manner, inquired, "How can I possibly follow such a delightful display of beauty and artistry?" In 1990, we purchased a large Victorian home in Jeffersonville, New York. We worked feverishly to upgrade the wiring and plumbing and to update the kitchen from its original 1800 minimalist fittings. We also built, ourselves, 5 private bathrooms, and on the 3rd floor we built a 3-bedroom owner's suite. In January of 1991, we opened the doors of our historical home as the Griffin House Bed and Breakfast. In 2007, we were awarded the Most Outstanding Bed and Breakfast of Distinction by the New York State Board of Tourism. After nearly 20 years of welcoming family, friends and guests to the Griffin House Bed and Breakfast, the time came for us to close the doors and bid adieu to another era in our lives. In 2010, we traveled south to Florida, where we are enjoying a well-earned retirement. My occupations were singer-entertainer, hospitality, and owner-proprietor Griffin House Bed and Breakfast. My nationality is British. I'm happy to have shared my deep story with you. Thanks so much for watching. Farewell, and wishing you fond memories.